Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Welcome you all on today's lecture at Theories of Profit, Module 17. I am Dr. Tilak Raj from University Business School, Punjab University, Chandigarh. The project name, Swayam Prabha, DTH, MHRD, New Delhi. We all familiar with the term profit. It is quite common, but different people use it in different sense. In economics, profit may be defined as net income of a business after all other costs like rent, wages, interest have been deducted from the total income. Profit are therefore uncertain and vary from person to person and maybe firm to firm. They have maybe zero profit, there can be zero profit. When total revenue is equal to total profit, there can be no profit. But when revenue will be more than cost, definitely there will be a profit. There are various theories developed by various economists. And we'll examine here some of important and well-known among them theories. And I'm sure after completion of this module, you will be able to learn what is profit, types of profit, difference between gross profit and net profit, various theories of profit such as risk theory of profit, rent theory of profit, marginal productivity theory of profit, risk theory of profit, rent theory of profit, labor exploitation theory of profit, and lastly, marginal productivity theory as well as the monopoly theory of profit. Now, first of all, what is a profit? I have already stated, profit is the reward for entrepreneurs. We have four factors of production: land, labor, capital and entrepreneurs. We pay rent for the use of land, interest for the use of capital, wages to the use of labor. Whereas this entrepreneur gets reward, that is called as profit. Profits show you how much money your company brings in. If financial gain, especially the difference between amount earned and the amount spent in buying, operating, producing something, etc., etc. So profit is surplus after paying all factors of production. Profit can be expressed that like this: profit is equal to value of output minus the input, what you have spent on to produce that commodity will deduct that from the output, means revenue. Profit consists two important component. One is a gross profit and second one net profit. Let us discuss what is a gross profit. Gross profit may also be referred as the sales or gross income. Gross profit arrives at after excluding all the explicit costs from the revenue received by the business. Explicit cost, we mean the payment made to the outsiders, like money costs. There are two types of costs: implicit and explicit. In the module costs, we have discussed in detail. Explicit means the payment made to the outsider, like for the raw material, for the electricity, for the labor, for the all the payment which is directly paid to the other factor of production. Whereas implicit cost means payment made to own self-employed or self-owned resources. So gross profit is equal to total revenue minus explicit cost. Simply, gross profit is equal to total revenue minus explicit cost. What you have, the total output, and what you have spent to produce a particular commodity, when we deduct the explicit cost from the total revenue, total earnings, then we have we can call gross profit. Profit in economics is the meant economic or pure profit. Let us discuss what are the main element of economic or pure profit. It include 6 element, like reward for taking risk. The main function of entrepreneurs is undertake the risk, and the reward that gets for taking risk include in economic profit. That is economic profit. Reward for bearing uncertainty. In business, you know that there are a lot of uncertainty. Entrepreneurs get the profit as a reward for bearing uncertainty. Risk or uncertainty there. There can be market condition, uncertainty market condition. Maybe competition, there's a lot of competition, there's uncertainty. Government policies, government interference can be through policies. So there can be a lot of uncertainty. And due to uncertainty, the reward paid to the entrepreneur is called the economic or pure profit. Third, reward for ability. Ability means skills, efficiency. With higher ability, make higher profit. And it is also the part of net profit. Fourth one, the monopoly gain. Monopoly gains. If the producer is a monopolist, or he can happen the monopoly, mainly monopoly power, to be operating in a monopoly market, then he charges high prices, and definitely what he will gets, that is the profit, that is reward. Windfall gain. Again, this is the reward paid for the, maybe sometime price of goods suddenly rise, and there can be windfall gains. Sixth, reward for innovation. Reward for innovation. When any entrepreneur introduce any innovation that reduce cost of production, and hence the price of the commodity, demanded, and that there will be high price, and due to high price, there will be a reward for innovation, or that this is the profit. Now, second part is net profit. Net profit also refers to the bottom line, net income or net earnings. This found on the last line of income statement. This number represent how much money a company has after all expenses paid. what you have spent to produce a particular commodity. After all these paid, what you have left, that is the net profit. Net profit simply is the surplus left over after deducting explicit as well as implicit cost from the sale receipts of the business. Explicit payment made to the outsider, implicit payment made to self-owned and self-employed resources. And after these payment, made these payment, what we have left, this is basically the net profit. Or net profit is equal to total revenue minus total explicit plus total implicit costs. Whereas in gross, we exclude only explicit cost. But in net profit, total revenue, total output minus explicit plus implicit, both costs. Or net profit is to gross profit minus implicit cost. Minus implicit cost. Now, what is the difference between gross profit and net profit? The main difference between gross profit and net profit are, number one, gross profit is a wider term and includes net profit also in it. Whereas gross profit include implicit cost and net profit does not include any such type of cost. Real loss, estimating from the total revenue and total costs, are relevant in context to the net profit, not in the gross profit. Now, the main focus of this module is on to discuss the theories of profit. So many theories have been put forward by way of explanation of profit. Let us examine some important and well-known among them. The first important theory is called dynamic theory of profit. And this theory has been developed by J.B. Clark. Second, innovation theory. This theory put forward by J.S. Schumpeter. Third, uncertainty bearing theory of profit by H. Knight. Similarly, risk theory of profit, F.E. Hawley, rent theory of profit, A. Walker, labor exploitation theory of profit by Karl Marx, and the marginal productivity theory, again Karl Marx, Wicksteed, etc. So let us discuss one by one all these theories briefly. First, dynamic theory of profit. This theory was propounded by J.B. Clark. Dynamic theory of profit. The profit arises due to dynamic changes in the economy. According to Clark, the profit is the reward to the entrepreneurs because of these dynamic changes in the economy. If the economy is static, there will be no reward, there is no profit. But if there is dynamic changes in the economy, and as a result of it, there will be profit. According to him, profit is the difference between cost of producing goods and the price of these goods. The cost of producing goods as well as and the price, the difference between this. The amount of cost and the amount which the entrepreneur receive, the difference between this is the profit. And it can emerge only in a dynamic society. If the society is static, there can be no profit, according to this theory. That's why this theory is called the dynamic theory of profit. dynamic theory of profit. Dynamic society we mean, or dynamic economy we means, with socio-economic factors like population and labor force, saving and investment, volume of capital, taste and preferences of the people, culture, etc., are always changing. These are not constant, whereas many theories assume that these are the constant, but here we have to assume that, or if these all these factors are changing in nature, then definitely there will be profit. J.B. Clark believed that profit arises in dynamic economy and not in the static economy. According to him, changes do not occur in static society. Changes do not occur in a static society. That's why there is no risk or uncertainty. So there the entrepreneur will get not any reward or profit in the economy. However, under dynamic condition, there is a disequilibrium between demand for and supply of goods. In such a state, in such an economy, in such type of the situation, there are often changes in the determinants of demand and supply, and Clark proposed that profit arise due to these dynamic changes. But there are some limitations of this theory. For example, according to dynamic theory, if the society is dynamic, only then entrepreneur would earn profit. And if they can earn profit, the supply of entrepreneurship increases, and consequently production in the society increases, which is not possible, which is not a practical in nature. This is just is an assumption that is it is possible. This theory of profit is not complete theory. That's why we cannot say that this theory is a complete theory, because of this theory does not explain all causes of the emergence of profit. There are a lot of causes for the emergence of the profit. Innovation can be the one of the, you know, that the scales of economy, and there are a lot of points which we can explain the reason of profit, not only the dynamic changes or dynamic economy. If there are changes take place, only then you have profit. This is not possible. The innovation theory, next second important theory, is called as the innovation theory of profit. Innovation theory of profit. This was propounded or proposed by Joseph Schumpeter. Schumpeter is an economist who have put forward the theory of innovation of profit. Innovation theory of profit. He said that entrepreneur earned profit for their innovative abilities. This theory focus on innovation, innovative abilities. Any entrepreneurs who have the innovative abilities, he will earn the profit, or the profit is due to innovative ideas, due to new inventions in the economy or in a production. He believed that when an entrepreneur introduces innovation in the business process, he or she will earn profit. If the innovation becomes successful in the marketplace, then he will get more profit. According to Schumpeter theory, any new process or policy adopted by entrepreneurs with a view to obtain reduction in the cost of production or to improve the demand for product in the marketplace can terms as innovation. So innovation is only the source of profit as per the innovation theory of profit given by Schumpeter. Innovation play a very, very important role in case of profit. Schumpeter's theory of profit hold that continuous innovations taking place in the market lead to increasing difference in the cost and price. When cost, if there is a cost, the difference between cost and price of the goods, there will be profit, and this difference will be due to innovation. Cost should be minimum, price should be maximum, and definitely as a result there will be profit, and there will be the profit will originate according to this theory. Schumpeter has said that if the entrepreneur can innovative a new product or a new model of an old product, if he can find new market for selling the product, then only he or she will able to increase the amount of profit. If he has capacity to find out new product, produce new product, innovative ideas, new market, only then he will be able to increase the amount of profit. Otherwise, entrepreneurs cannot increase the profit. He will not get any reward due to his efforts. It means this increase in profit, the innovation induced profit. Innovation induced means profit is dependent on innovation. More innovation, more profit, less innovation, less profit. So it is innovation induced profit. Innovative theory of profit is basically innovation induced profit theory. But again, there are limitations of the innovation theory of profit. The first important limitation, the economist criticized that the profit earned by the entrepreneurs as a result of several activities and not just innovation. This is the most important limitation or criticism of this theory, that profit cannot be alone a part of innovation, but it is a result of several other activities. So you cannot claim that profit is just the result of a new innovation. This can be one part, but you cannot claim that whole profit is the result of innovation. They opined that opinion, according to them, that Schumpeter's description of the function of an entrepreneur was too narrow. This theory cannot fully explain why profit arises and why the entrepreneur should earn profit. This just focus only one part, that innovation and new market, new ideas, etc. Next, for example, we know that entrepreneur may obtain profit as the reward of bearing risk or uncertainty for his ability to establish monopolistic domains. If he become the monopolist, if he has a monopoly power, then he can earn more profit, he can discriminate the price, he can earn more profit, if and many other reasons are there. But Schumpeter did not consider these factors that might work behind the emergence of the profit. That's why this theory has been criticized by various economists. Third is the uncertainty bearing theory of profit. Next important theory is uncertainty bearing theory of profit. Uncertainty bearing theory of profit was proposed by Frank H. Knight. According to Knight, bearing uncertainty bearing the uncertainty in business is the most important function of an entrepreneur. Entrepreneur has only one important function, that he has to bear uncertainty business. He has to face a lot of unexpected uncertainty in the market. He further divided risk into two parts, insurable and non-insurable. So as to make distinction between risk and uncertainty. This can be insurable. This cannot be insurable. So first, insurable risk. These are the risks which an entrepreneur can avoid with the help of insurance cover. Insurable risk, which can be avoided by covering the insurance, with the help of covering insurance. If you have the insurance of the product, you can avoid this risk. For example, risk of accident, theft, fire, maybe, etc. And this type of risk also known as certain risk. Insurable risk also called as certain risks. Hence, the questions of profit does not arise according to Schumpeter. Second, non-insurable risk or uncertainty risk. Non-insurable risk are unpredictable, which you cannot predict, you cannot measure. Insurable, you can predict, you can have a measurable capacity, but the non-insurable risk you cannot predict, you cannot even avoid. And hence, there are uncertainties. Entrepreneurs incur losses in the business due to unforeseen circumstances like price level fluctuation, demand pattern, etc. So also, entrepreneurs cannot cover such risk through insurance, which cannot cover through insurance. Fluctuation in prices, change in the taste and preferences of the consumer, sudden the fluctuation in the economy, you cannot have insurance. And these risks alone give the profit. According to Schumpeter, the non-insurable, uncertain risk is the result of profit. And this arises alone the profit. Insurable risk cannot give any profit, but non-insurable, uncertain risks give the rise to profit to the entrepreneur. Uncertain risks are due to the following reasons. One, risk of competition. First, risk of competition. There is a competition in the market, and maybe you can survive or maybe you can have a loss. So the reward due to this competition is the profit. It arises out of the unforeseen changes in the business related policies of the competitors. Maybe competitor will change the policy, maybe reduce the price, maybe have a new innovative ideas, and this is definitely one of the risk of the competition in the market. And due to this, there will be uncertainty. Risk arising due to change in technology, changes in technologies. It arises when the present technology that is being used by the entrepreneurs become obsolete. There is no role of that technology. There is no importance of now. And you have to change with advancement in the technologies in the economy. And there is a lot of risk. Third, market conditions risk. It arises due to change in occurring in the economy as a result of change in trade cycle. Maybe inflation in the economy, maybe deflation, and maybe there can be some sudden change in the economy, and that's why there's a market risk, market conditions risk in the economy. Government policy risk is there. And all these risks, basically the profit is the reward of all these risks. Government policy risk, If the government will change, policy will change. Maybe taxation policy, maybe other policies. It arises when change in policies of the government affect the business of entrepreneur adversely. When government impose some limitations, when government impose some restrictions on the on a particular business or maybe some taxes, definitely that will adversely affect the business of a particular entrepreneurs. And they say this is called government policy risk. The policies can be in the form of change in foreign trade policy, maybe tax laws, and maybe some other restrictions can be there or some policies. So according to Knight, the profit is a reward earned by entrepreneur for bearing risk and uncertainty of the doing business. According to this theory, profit is a reward earned by the entrepreneurs for bearing various type of risk which we have discussed and due to uncertainty in the business, in the economy. He argued that profit did not originate because of dynamic condition. He criticized the dynamic theory of profit, that which says that profit is only the result of dynamic conditions or change in the economy. But according to this theory, whole focus is on uncertainty bearing of risks. There are various of risks in the production, and due to this, these risks, there's a result, whatever the entrepreneur bearing these risks and uncertainty doing the business, that is the profit. He said that it is uncertainty about the changes in the market condition that led profit. Uncertainty in the market conditions that rise to the profit, originate the profit. Again, this theory, we cannot say that complete theory. There are limitations. So let us discuss limitations of uncertainty bearing theory of profit. The theory discusses about only one function of entrepreneurs, that is uncertainty bearing only. Again, this is most important limitation or drawbacks of this theory. Economists criticized that the theory talks about profit only the macro perspective, not specific. This theory also ignores other determinants of the profits, like innovation. This is a vague theory of profit determination. Risk, only risk bearing cannot be the origin, cannot be the part of profit only. Now, next important theory is risk theory of profit. We have done risk bearing theory. Now, risk theory of profit. This is a separate theory. The risk bearing theory of profit was developed by F. V. Hawley in 1907-80. Risk theory of profit. According to him, profit is a reward of risk bearing. Previous theory, profit is due to uncertainty. Here, due to risk only. The main function of entrepreneur is to bear the risk. Production involves various kind of risks and other emergency expenses. And the business that involves high risks give more profit and vice versa. According to risk theory of profit, the business which involved high risk will give more profit to the entrepreneurs. And the business which involves less risk will give less profit to the entrepreneur. Profit is directly related to the risk according to this theory. If risk is more, profit will be more. If risk will be less, profit will be less. According to this theory, any type of risk gives a rise to profit, regardless the risk is involvement or not. So whole theory depends upon the risk bearing. According to Hawley, there is a proportional relationship between risk and profit. High risk of the entrepreneur, greater will be the profit. Low risk of entrepreneur, lower will be his profit. So on contrary, low risk, lesser will be the profit. High risk, greater will be the profit. So according to this theory, entrepreneur have to bear the following risk basically. For example, one, first is the replacement risk. Second, proper risk. Third, uncertainty. And now the degree of risk varies different to business. For example, replacement risk refers to the depreciation. Replacement risk refers to the depreciation. It can be deducted and so is included in the cost of production. So therefore, it does not give a rise to any profit. Second, risk proper arises due to time lag between the production of goods and their sale. During this time lag, there can be so many unforeseen changes, and consequently, the entrepreneur may have to bear the loss. An entrepreneur would be willing to undertake these risks only if he gets reward for the same, and this reward is called profit. Uncertainty, we have already discussed. You cannot predict the future. Future is unpredictable. Taste and preferences, demand for the product, and maybe lot of unforeseen the things are there in the market. So you cannot predict. So risk is basically due to replacement. There is a replacement risk, proper risk, and uncertainty risk. But the degree of risk varies in different business. Now let us discuss the limitations of risk theory of profit. Profit is not directly related with the risk. Many economists argue that it is not directly related with the risk. If the business involves high risk, there is more profitability of the failure and loss rather than the profit. Some of economists say, no, if there is more risk, then there is more possibility of the profit. And profit earned only if the risk is successfully avoided. Whereas this theory says, no, more risk means more profit. Whereas economists argue that profit earned only if risk is successfully avoided. Maybe by using the skills, education, knowledge, experience, etc. So it is not earned mere taking the risk. Or risk bearing means doesn't mean more profit. According to this theory, risk seems to be the factor of production. What factor of production is organized, not risk. Similarly, organization earns profit not only taking the risk, but for other things. There are all things are performed, which as a result we have the profit. So all risk does not give rise to profit. Only the unforeseeable risk or non-insurable risk gives your rise the profit. Now next theory is the rent theory of profit. Rent theory of profit was propounded by F.A. Walker. who believed that profit is regarded as a rent of differential ability that an entrepreneur may be possess over the others. Like the rent, there's a differential ability that an entrepreneur may be possess over the others. In the rent theory, we have discussed that rent arises due to different fertility of the land. There's various types of land, A grade, B grade, C grade, we have done. And the profit is due to this differential, the fertility or ability of the land. Similarly, Walker says that the entrepreneurs acquire profit because of his ability to perform. Means this theory of profit works on the same principle as that land of rent, which is the difference between yielding of least and most effective fertile lands. We have already discussed that in theory of rent, that first there is a maybe most fertile land and maybe least fertile land, and the difference between most and least effective fertile land is the result of that rent. So rent theory of profit for Ricardian theory of rent is also, we have discussed that rent is zero on marginal land, and less the cost of production and the more productivity on a plot of land, the more would be the rent enjoyed by its owners. Because of this similarity between the profit rent, Walker theory is called rent theory of profit. That's why we called the Walker theory, we called as a rent theory of profit, because there is a similarity between the Ricardian theory of rent as well as the Walker theory of rent. Rent theory of profit. Likewise, the profit is the rent of least and most efficient entrepreneurs, according to Walker. Generally, the least efficient worker tries too hard to cover only the cost of production, while the efficient worker earns extra for the differential abilities. Thus, the rent theory of profit basically refers that the profit of an entrepreneur depends on the, you know, that degree of which his ability are exceptionally different or unique over the others. If I have the abilities which is exceptionally good, which is exceptionally different or unique from others, you will be able to earn more profit. The Walker's theory of profit is based on the assumption that the state of perfect competition prevails. This again, although the limitation of this theory, but the whole theory based on the state of perfect competition means there is homogeneous, the, you know, that factors of production. Homogeneous means the same quality, identical factor of production, wherein all the firms are presumed to obtain the same managerial ability. This theory assumes that all the firm has the same managerial ability. You cannot differentiate the abilities of one firm with another firm, their efficiency of one firm with other firm. They have equal efficiency, they are equal able to produce the commodity. Each firm would draw wages for management ability, which in the workers' point of view do not form a part of the pure profit. And the wages or the wages of management are regarded as ordinary wages. Thus, under the perfect competition scenario, there will be no pure profit. Each firm will be earn management wages, which is known as the normal profit, according to this theory. So this theory again is not a complete theory. You cannot say this is the efficient theory. No, Walker's theory of profit is mainly criticized due to inability to explain the nature of profit. He is not able to explain what is nature of profit. It provides only the measure of profit and not its real nature, which is of utmost importance. The assumption that Profits arises due to the differential ability of entrepreneur does not always stand true. This is just unrealistic assumptions. This is not true. This is not practical. The rise in the profit could also be due to the entrepreneur's monopoly in the market. There are a lot of reasons for to earn the profit. Now, next one, labor exploitation theory of profit. This is one of the important theory of this, the profit. Labor exploitation theory of profit. Exploitation of labor is the act of using power systematically extract more value from the workers than is given to them. So it is social relationship based on an asymmetry of power between the workers and their employees. This theory was developed by Karl Marx. So according to Karl Marx, labor is only the factor of production which can produce the surplus value. According to Karl Marx, labor has only the capacity to produce. This is only the productive sector. This is the factor which can produce the surplus only. Other factor cannot produce any surplus, like land, capital, entrepreneurs. So capitalists acquire profit by exploiting the surplus of value. Marx has said that labor is only the productive factor. Labor is given the rate of wage, which is much smaller than the net value produced by it, and with the help of machines or raw material. What the efforts are made by the laborer, they will not be rewarded accordingly. The payment made to the laborer is very less as compared to their efforts, their productivity, what they produce, the value. That's why they say this is the result of the profit. The surplus value is defined the difference between net value produced by the labor and what is actually gets wage. Here, the net value produced by the labor is more, but actually what they get, the wages are very less. And this is the reason of the profit, main reason of the profit. This surplus value is the profit of the entrepreneur who represent the capitalists. Basically, here entrepreneurs is treated by the Karl Marx as capitalists. There would be an increase in the productivity of labor when this profit is converted into capital and invested again. For now, the labor would be able to use more capital, more goods or machines. As a result of it, there will be more profit to the capitalists. As the productivity of labor increases, the surplus of value created by the labor also increases. As the productivity of labor increases, the value produced by, value commodity produced or created by the labor also increases. So the rate of value of the worker generally does not increase or increase at much the smaller rate. Means the labor are not paid according to their productivity. They are able to produce more output, more value. That's why there is a more profit. And thus exploitation of labor goes on increasing at an increasing rate. Along with it, the stock of capital also increases and the profit of the capitalist increases. But again, there are some limitations of this theory. In the labor exploitation theory of profit, the role of labor in the creation of surplus value and the subject of labor exploitation have been rightly emphasized. But however, many economists think that like labor, other factor production like land, capital are also productive. Not only labor is only the productive sector. Physiograd says only the agriculture, agriculture or sorry land is only the productive in the sector that has only the capacity to produce something, other sector cannot produce anything. So Marx has said that it is capitalists that acquire profit. He thinks that capitalists are identical with the entrepreneurs. Although in modern economic system, entrepreneurs and capitalists may be separate persons. Whereas Karl Marx says no, they are identical. Capitalists and entrepreneurs are the identical or maybe the same person. Lastly, Marx does not consider the fact that sometimes the entrepreneurs may have to bear the risk or uncertainty. So, therefore, Marx's theory too cannot be considered to be a complete theory of profit. Now, next, marginal productivity theory of profit. This is one of the most important theory. Already we have done some part of the marginal productivity. We know what is marginal productivity. We have studied how the marginal productivity of theory of factor pricing may be applied to the determination of the rates of wages and interest. So we shall now study how far the theory is relevant in determining the rate of profit. The marginal product refers to the increase in amount of output by addition of one unit of factor of production while keeping the other factors constant. The increase in the output with the addition of one unit of factor of production is known as the marginal productivity. Marginal productivity means additional productivity. The increase in output with the addition of one unit of factors of production is known as the marginal productivity. Marginal productivity. So, the marginal productivity theory says that the price of a factor would be equal to the value of its marginal productivity. The price of the factor is equal to the value of marginal productivity. Therefore, according to this theory, the rate of profit would be equal to the value of marginal product of the entrepreneurs or entrepreneurial services. According to the definition of marginal product of the entrepreneurship is the increment in total output obtained as a result of use of the marginal unit of entrepreneurial services. Therefore, according to marginal productivity theory, the rate of profit would be equal to the value of marginal productivity of the entrepreneurs and entrepreneurial services. And if the value of marginal productivity of entrepreneurial services is greater than the rate of profit determined in the market, then entrepreneurial would be go on increasing the amount of entrepreneurial services used till the value of marginal productivity of these services diminishes, owing to law of diminishing margin return, the law of diminishing margin return to become equal to the rate of profit. So here law of diminishing margin is applicable according to this theory. So marginal productivity theory, again, there are some limitations. In general, assumes that there is perfect competition in both product and factor market. It's not possible. Therefore, the theory assumes that there is perfect competition in the market for the entrepreneurial services. Again, this is one of the important limitations. That is, the buyer and sellers of these services are large numbers and sellers are selling homogeneous product. They are the price taker. They cannot influence the price of the market. So the price are determined by the industry and they are the just price taker. Services of all entrepreneurs cannot be homogeneous. Some of entrepreneurs may be more efficient and some may be less efficient. So you cannot treated all the entrepreneurs as the same homogeneous in nature. The seller of these services are also not large number in the real world. Again, this is the one of the limitation of this theory. Also, the existence of perfect competition in the market for these services implies that price or the rate of profit is determined by the market forces, demand and supply forces, market mechanism, where the price of anything is decided by the demand and supply forces of the market. One, that is the pure profit above the normal is said to be the monopoly characteristics by the single seller without any close substitute. And second, monopoly theory of profit suggests that the firms enjoy the monopoly power, restrictions output, charges higher prices for its producers and services than under the perfect competition. Monopoly theory of profit is another important theory of profit. And many economists think that if there is a perfect competition in the market, there cannot be any profit. Monopoly, I'm sorry. This is the next important theory, which is monopoly theory of profit. And the monopoly theory or the of the profit, many economists think that there is a perfect competition in the markets, whereas there cannot be any profit because of the absence of competition. Creation creates opportunities and the market to acquire the profit. So as we know, under perfect competition, buyers and sellers assumes possess full knowledge about the condition prevailing in the market. But if the entrepreneur possesses the monopoly power in the market, then he would have to, you know, that earn, exert individual initiative in giving the leadership in the market. And now, in order to maintain his monopoly power and to increase this power, he would have to exercise the necessary efforts, and that is the result of the profit. And the entrepreneur has to bear the risk and uncertainty, and he would have to expand the dominance of his firm in the market through innovations. And if entrepreneur can perform his job successfully, then he can increase the demand of his product and will get higher price and will get profit, and consequently the amount of pure profit earned by him by maybe increases due to these efforts. So monopoly theory may be that there can be some factors which arise the monopoly, maybe due to economies of scale, that is cost decrease with increase in production, mergers and takeovers, ownership of unique materials, legal sanctions of the protection, etc. So according to monopoly theory of profit, an entrepreneur can earn pure profit, which is also called as the monopoly profit, and can maintain it for a longer time period by using the monopoly power. And this power, monopoly, to control the supply and price of the product. Power to prevent the entry of new competitors in the market by pricing cutting. And in certain situations, a monopoly power to control or regulate certain inputs in the market. Thus, a firm under the monopoly can use any of these power to earn pure profit or more profit. Thus, monopoly serve as an important source to make the pure profit. Now, lastly, the profit policies. Profit policies basically helps entrepreneur to work under the service condition. Profit policies give entrepreneurs a clear picture about the rate of profit the business ought to earn and what would be the profit performance of the business in the long run. While drafting profit policy, entrepreneurs must take into consideration of the following two important issues. Now, let us discuss the part of the policy, profit policy, which we have left. While drafting the policies of entrepreneur must take into consideration the following issues. In the previous slide I was discussing that standard of reasonable profit, and second one, reasons for limiting profits. Now, standard of reasonable profit, we mean in setting standards of reasonable profit, an entrepreneur selects a specific concept and measure to profit earned by the business. The entrepreneur uses these standards to compare the expected and achieved results the businesses. The reasons for limiting profits. In today's business environment, ownership is separated from the management of businesses. Thus, business houses are answerable to various stakeholders like shareholders, creditors, employers, government, customers, and the society as at a large. Now, let us summarize whole this theories of profit. In this module, we have discussed the meaning and types of profit. One, profit is the reward received by the entrepreneurs for using their entrepreneurial abilities and running a business, we have discussed. Various economists proposed various theories and tried to explain the emergence and the origin of the profits. And these theories can be broadly classified traditional and modern theories. Basically, prominent among the traditional theories like rent theory of workers, and some of important modern theories, dynamic theory of profit, innovation theory of profit, and uncertainty bearing theories. These are basically modern theories. So, in the last profit policies we have discussed, profit policies help entrepreneur in running the business under the diverse conditions. With this, thank you very much.